What's going on, guys? It's Danny here, and this is gonna be a 3.4K average MMR game commentary. Not gonna be going through the whole picking phase. If you want to hear commentary about the picking phase, you can go to my previous videos of this type. Not gonna be pausing the game a lot. And let's just do it. We got no time to waste. Alright. Radiant team. We got Rubik, Phantom Assassin, Axe, Shadow Fiend, and an Omni Knight. I don't see a very good offlaner except Axe, but solo offlane Axe is not very good. The best option I see for the Radiant team here is to go Omni Knight, Axe, offlane, Shadow Fiend middle, of course, and bottom lane is a pretty good Rubik PA lane. Dire team, they have a Juggernaut, Vengeful Spirit, Earthshaker, Jakiro, and a Viper. They don't have a good offlaner either. I don't see one. They do have the Earthshaker though. Earthshaker is a good option. You can see the Earthshaker in like the recent tournaments and the competitive matches, the professional matches. People play him on the offlane a lot. They go offlane Earthshaker. I think that's what they should do this game. Oh man, oh, he could have tried for a fissure block here, but he didn't want to. So could have gone offlane Earthshaker and then duo lane, top lane or tri lane actually with Vengeful Spirit, Jakiro and Juggernaut. It's a really good tri lane, safe lane, and of course the Viper 1v1 against the Shadow Fiend middle. Let's see what's going to happen here. And it's going to be the first blood fight. Earthshaker is actually saving the fissure pretty well there. Very well done. Viper does take the rune. And this Axe is dead. This Axe is so dead. Omni Knight, run for your life. Shadow Fiend, run away as well. So this was basically 3v4. Three heroes from the Radiant. Oh, fissure, hello. That fissure actually helps Radiant a little bit. And there goes the trash talk already. 0 minute into the game, trash talk. Thank you, says Omni Knight. The fissure did help them. It blocked the creeps a little bit, actually. But they are still going to be okay. let's see what's going to happen here. This is basically tri-lane. Jakiro, Juggernaut and Earthshaker. Not the tri-lane, I thought. It's going to be offlane Vengeful Spirit. Vengeful Spirit carry, man. Vengeful Spirit played as a core. I don't know. Pro players do that, but it doesn't mean that you have to copy pro players in everything they do. Because you might not be able to do it as good as they do it. Let me see what happens here on the lane first. Jakiro completely missing the skill, actually. Should have gone for the Omni Knight instead. They cannot kill anyone. The heal too strong. It's a not bad lane. Meanwhile, Earthshaker, he's pulling the creeps. He stack and pull creeps. And this is another creep wave going under the tower. No mango on Earthshaker. Very bad, Earthshaker. Very bad. Definitely should have a mango. Some people even get two mangoes in the starting build for Earthshaker. It's really good. It's super useful. It could be, you know, it could secure your kill if you get a mango. So make sure you get one on Earthshaker, at least one. Alright, I definitely think Dire team should be winning this lane. Axe should definitely not be killing these ancients. They are way too hard for him to kill. And also, you're not here to jungle, you're here to, you know, go aggressive with Omni Knight together. Earthshaker is looking for another pull. The pull is okay because the lane will be pushing in. They have two ranged creeps versus one, that means the lane will be pushing in. But he's not pulling anymore. They are actually trying to kill. Omni Knight went to the secret shop to finish the soul ring, and he got blocked by the fissure. That's a very good fissure right there. I don't think this offlane is going to work. Shaker, Juggernaut and Jakiro is a really strong lane. that I don't think they should be playing against. One very good option would be for Axe to go into the jungle, because this is clearly not going to work out. Like, I know it's not gonna work out looking at the picks, and Axe is dead actually. Looking at the heroes, I know it's not gonna work out, and this is a 3400 average MMR game, remember that. So people, you know, people are okay. I believe that's the average. The average is around that number. 3.4k or 3k, something like that is the average of Dota. The average MMR of the Dota players. They know what they are doing. Obviously, not very high skill players. That's what we are here to do. Judge, criticize the mistakes and everything that they do, so you guys can learn something hopefully from this video. Middle lane, Shadowfiend versus Viper. Viper just picked up a haste rune, and it's definitely a good decision to dive under the tower. Alright, he gets raised, uses the stick as well. Oh my god, man, that Shadowfiend? That Shadowfiend looks more tanky than I expected him to be. So Shadowfiend killed Viper first, and then Shadowfiend died because of the poisons. Whoa, this is something I want to talk about. But basically, Shadowfiend getting... Oh, he's tipping top now. He wants to gank the top lane. Let's see what happens over here. One raise, didn't hit the Juggernaut. Nothing actually. They just back off, and this is wasted time on the Shadowfiend. If this was a 6k average game or 5.5k plus, the Shadowfiend wouldn't have done that rotation. It's very important that Shadowfiend farms. He's a carry hero. He needs to be farming a lot early game. Meanwhile, middle, Viper going on Rubick. And he will get that kill. And then Shadowfiend. Nice. He gets the return kill. He gets pinked by the Rubick as well, but I don't know why. He gets the return kill. It's okay. As a support, you know, it's okay to trade yourself for a kill when your carry gets a kill. This is basically, what it's about, right? The supports are kind of the sacrificed heroes. They can trade themselves, and the carries should always be looking to get farm and to get good trades out of the fights. Carries should not be trading themselves every fight for enemy kills, you know. And obviously they are carries, they get the farming priority and stuff like that. Shadowfiend is a carry, so I don't know why did Rubick ping there, but it's okay that one for one trade. That was an okay one. Alright, Viper. Oh, whoa, whoa, that... Oh my god, that last raise. Let me... I'm not gonna see it again. He basically just missed it. That last raise. It would have been a kill, I think. Might have been a kill. Viper has some bottle charges, so I don't know, but it could have been a kill there. There was a possibility. Can we take a look at the... off lane? We can do that later. First, Viper, Nether Toxin, must have, guys. You must skill Nether Toxin. It's really, really, really good. Helps you last hit on the lane, because on the middle you are playing a 1v1 lane. Helps you last hit against the enemy. A lot of damage you get from it. You also get damage on the enemy player. It's non-hero damage is 50%. By the way, I know I will be missing kills during this game, but I actually want to talk about stuff that you guys can learn from. I'm not here to watch every single kill that happens in the game. Otherwise, if I wanted to do that, I would be watching a pro match. In this one, I want to commentate in a different way, right? I'm saying that because this game has like... I don't know, I think more than 120 kills at the end of the game, and that's a lot of kills. and I will be missing some, but meanwhile I will be talking about important stuff that hopefully you guys learn from. How do I know there are more than 120 kills? Well, this is my third time recording this game. I have been here for 3 hours. I'm not complaining or anything. I love it. But I'm just saying how I know that there are 120 kills. Viper, Nether Toxin, must have in the early game. I think the perfect, the best build for Viper. Look at him. He doesn't deal so much damage, actually. Omni Knight coming from behind. That was a triple raise by the Shadow Fiend, but couldn't kill Viper. Nether Toxin, good damage against creeps and heroes. Definitely helps a lot. The perfect Viper build would be to have 1 point of poison attack, 2 in Nether Toxin, 2 in Corrosive Skin, skill the ultimate whenever possible. He's straight up walking to the bottom lane into the PA. It's a little bit awkward. Vengeful Spirit swaps him back. Earthshaker. He's not level 6. He doesn't have Echo Slam. But it's okay. Viper gets the kill on... Vengeful Spirit gets the kill on Axe. And Axe goes down there. So gank was successful, actually. Meanwhile, on the top lane, Juggernaut gets a double kill as well. Radiant team getting wrecked all over the place right now. The only one getting good trade from this is the Shadow Fiend. And that's okay, because remember, carry hero, good trades. If Shadow Fiend TP'd bottom, he might have died, who knows. Meanwhile, on the middle lane, he got like 10 last hits and he got the tier 1 tower. And now he bought a Blink Dagger. Blink Dagger on Shadow Fiend. Wait, did I finish the Viper thoughts? I think I did. Let's see what happens here first. Rubik. They are trying to kill, but they can't kill anyone. Alright, Viper. I'm just gonna make the camera follow the hero that I'm talking about. Viper is dead now. That's really good for PA, and I think he is fine. There is Echo Slam. Oh, he could have echoed instead of Enchant Totem. There is Fissure now. Whoa, Shadow Fiend, what's going on, guys? Blink in and... Omni Knight, no! That was not so good by the Omni Knight. He definitely should have healed Shadow Fiend. It's all about Shadow Fiend surviving. We are coming back to the point. Supports and carries. Sacrifices and getting good trades out of the fights, right? In that case, Omni Knight definitely should have made the sacrifice, healed the Shadow Fiend, and then Shadow Fiend would have killed everybody. Omni Knight doesn't really get anything from surviving that fight. If Shadow Fiend survived instead, that would have been like a triple kill for him. And Shadow Fiend is the one that carries, so it's really good to have the triple kill on him instead of Omni Knight surviving. And he's not even gonna survive, he's dead. He died to Viper. So yeah, definitely Omni Knight could have done a little sacrifice there. Viper. Let me go back to the Viper, guys. Nether Toxin definitely must have. The perfect Viper build would be 1-2-2-1. Level 6, 1-2-2-1. Sometimes if you are playing, for example, if you're playing against the Queen of Pain and she Shadow Strikes you a lot and you take damage from it, and then you can max Corrosive Skin because it's very good magical resistance, and also you return the poison that slows attack speed, movement speed, and deals damage over time. The Corrosive Skin is insane slow. It's so much better than the poison attack, actually. Poison attack maxed is not good. By the way, the mechanism, perfect choice for the Viper in this game. Viper is a perfect mechanism carry hero, and mechanism on a core hero instead of support means that it will be earlier because the core hero farms. And yeah, mechanism, very good choice on the Viper here. So if you're playing against someone that you trade attacks with a lot, you can max the corrosive skin. If you're playing against if the enemy team is roaming a lot, like let's say they have two supports that constantly gank you on the mid lane, you should max the corrosive skin so you have more resistance and the poison is really strong. Definitely much stronger than the poison attack. Now Omni Knight TP bottom, but I don't think that's a good choice because nobody else is TPing. They either need more people to TP or Shadow Fiend to try to escape. Nice raises there. Vengeful Spirit almost died. And this is okay because more people are TPing from the Radiant team. What did he steal? Viper Strike. Very nice spell to steal. Viper's ultimate. Echo Slam! Wow, very well done there. The 3-man Fissure followed by the 3-man Echo Slam. Mega kill on the Juggernaut. Battle Fury up. One last thing about the Viper. It's much better to max Nether Toxin and Corrosive Skin before Poison Attack. That, together with everything I said until now about the Viper, I'm going to stop with the Viper. Another thing, before I stop talking about the Viper only. Viper is a good hero for beginners, guys. Everyone, not only me, gets everyone that gets the question a lot of the question, what's good hero for beginners? Viper is, he's a very tanky hero, he has very basic abilities that don't require any skill. He has two passives, so basically passives, you don't have to do anything for them to work, they are passive spells. Viper is one of the heroes that's good for beginners. You can definitely use it if you are new to the game. Alright, let's see what else is there. Rubick is trying to ward and deward. He did ward and deward before he died. Shouldn't really do it, to be honest, because everyone saw you doing this. Also, the ward is not in a perfect place. It should be like here on the edge because it's not giving vision here. The ward is a little bit into the trees, but it's still better than not having any vision, I guess. Alright, so enough about the Viper. Let's go into the other hero, Jakiro. Jakiro maxing Dual Breath, Liquid Fire, no points of Ice Path. Alright, they are going on PA, they cannot kill PA. The Ice Path really depends. The Ice Path is easy to dodge by the enemy. If you don't have any stuns in your team, you can get a point of it, so you can cancel TPs. But Ice Path should definitely not be used as main disable, because it's not the perfect disable. Alright, what's going on in here? Juggernaut, right-clicking the Rubick down. Now Omni Slash on PA, jumps on creeps. Unlucky jumps on creeps, actually. And oh, very nice reaction and very good, very well done there. When Omni Knight repels the PA, he immediately turns for the Omni Knight. And oh, another great Fissure plus Echo Slam by the Earthshaker. Got him. Alright, now Shadow Fiend, Blink Dagger, Power Treads. This is a Yasha, and he can build either Sanjin Yasha or Manta Style. We will see what he's going to be building. What do I personally think though? Sanjin Yasha or Manta in this game? I think Manta. You can remove the Viper's Strike, I believe. I'm not 100% sure. I think so. So when Viper strikes you, you can just Manta and remove that. Also, the Manta illusions are good at tanking the Juggernaut Omnislash. If you get a Sanjin Yasha, you do get HP from the Sanj, of course, but Manta style is okay against Juggernaut to tank some of the Omnislash jumps. Also, the Manta gives you HP because you get Ultimate Orb. Ultimate Orb increases all of your stats. Alright, so there is going to be a fight here. Let's see what happens. Hux dies first. Earthshaker has a Blink Dagger this time. Our Echo Slam is not up. Couldn't really stun the PA. Omnislash on the background. Triple kill for Juggernaut. And that's a team wipe. Now after the team wipe, they can go push some towers. Healing ward, very important, keep in mind. After the team fight, you just use the healing ward. Heal everybody, keep pushing, you don't have to go back to base. The mid lane tier 1 tower is okay here, Jakiro is gonna be getting it. Should be careful because people can TP and gank him. This is a 5-man Dota moment. Do something as a team. Keep in mind that in Dota, most of the things will be done as a team. Like, you win the game as a team, you lose the game as a team, you push together as a team, and this is exactly what's happening. Jakiro is dying on the mid lane. He will get the middle tower, I believe. Vengeful Spirit is here. Could have swapped the Jakiro to try to save Jakiro. Jakiro destroyed the tower. And then he died. I guess it's worth it. Dying for a tier 1. Bottom lane tower. They didn't even destroy it. I don't know why. Should definitely focus on objectives a lot. Oh, PA jumping in. That Battle Fury though. Alright. Oh my god, another big Echo Slam. Rubik stole the Echo Slam actually. And used it. That's a triple kill for the Shaker. And a double for Shadow Fiend. Whoa, man. What a nice Echo once again. By the way, there is something I forgot to say in the beginning of the game. Or I don't remember actually if I said it or not. Axe and... I think I did say it. Axe and... Or maybe I said it the previous time I tried to record this game. This video. Axe could have gone jungle in the beginning of the game. Because they are getting pretty owned. I mean, they got owned on the top lane. So what they should have done is Axe go to the jungle to try to farm a Blink Dagger. Because it's a must. Like, Axe without a Blink Dagger, it's really bad. And definitely should take it easy and not fight so much. Basically, the team that's losing right now is Radiant. And they need important items before starting to fight for the comeback. They need... The most important item is the Blink Dagger on Axe. So they could have just waited for an Axe's dagger. Alright, Fissure. PA is repelled by the Omni Knight. Very good. Omni Knight PA, very good combo. Earthshaker goes down. Jakiro goes down as well. Now, Vengeful Spirit is too late to the party and he's going to die. Viper is there as well. He is going to die as well, that's for sure. Can turn around and poison or Viper Strike. Mechanism is up, Magic Wand is up, but it won't help him survive. They would have killed him anyway for sure. Even if he used Mech and Magic Wand. So that was a really good trade. 0-4-4 trade for the Radiant team. They are getting back into the game. Slowly. They aren't even losing that hard. It's only 5k, 2.5k gold advantage, Dire's 23 minutes into the game. Attack. It's not a huge advantage. And after that fight, Axe bought his blink, so there we go. Dire's we got the mobility that Axe needs. Let's take a look at Shadow Fiend, right? Shadow Fiend, Blink Dagger. Yasha, something on the courier. There is a Sanjin Yasha, so he's going for Sanjin Yasha. It's okay. I'm not saying Sanjin Yasha is bad, it's okay. But I think Manta is good too. Manta and BKB. If you look at the Dire team in this game, they have an Earthshaker. Tons of magical damage. They have a Jakiro too. Another hero with tons of magical damage. And they have a Veil of Discord as well. Very good choice to go for a Veil of Discord here. It increases his damage because he deals magical damage with all the spells and Shadow Fiend, I mean Earthshaker's damage at the same time. Alright, let's see. Omni Knight. Oh! Another very good. Oh my god, this Earthshaker. This Earthshaker is being on point. This is one big team fight that I would like to analyze a little bit. I said I'm not going to pause for a long time. It's not going to be a long pause, but this is a big team fight that I would like to analyze a little bit. First of all, Omni Knight, hero that number one thing to do is positioning. Good position so you can heal, repel, Guardian Angel. Let's see what happens this game. They start by taking Roshan. They are smoked into the Rosh pit. Now Dire team wants to fight. Obviously they don't want them to have Rosh. And then look at Omni Knight. He was casting the Guardian Angel. Oh my god. That was like, I don't know if Earthshaker was aiming for it or not. So far all the Echo Slams have been really good, so I guess he was aiming for it, but that was the perfect Echo Slam. It was right before Omni Knight got the Guardian Angel off. Like, you can see how Omni tried to walk in and Guardian Angel. Now, don't get me wrong guys, I'm not blaming the whole team wipe on the Omni Knight here. You should never do that. Remember, Dota is a team game. And it's a team game now, I mean, how should I... Now, Dota is a team game more than ever. Yeah, there we go. I know English. I'm not that bad. Okay, now it's a team game more than ever. Because of how the game is evolving and how things are changing. Especially in the current meta, 6.86 is basically the same like 6.85. The meta was not changed. There are just new heroes. The meta is the same. Go fight. Now, keep in mind, 3400 MMR. People do have an idea, of course, about the game and the meta and all that stuff. But they are not so good. Like, for example, you can't compare 3k player to a 5k player. The 5k player will have more knowledge and more understanding about the game. Especially more understanding. I don't know about knowledge. There are some 4k players with more knowledge than 5k players because they have been playing the game forever. But understanding of the game and adjusting to different situations and different metas and stuff like that. That's about the high MMR, like understanding how the game works at the moment and not playing the game like you used to 1 year ago. For example, 1 year ago it was okay to have AFK farming carries and then one guy carries five other guys, but now it's not good that now you can never go AFK farming carry. Now you need to fight. You need to be in the fights. You need to team play. I was talking about something before I started talking about the meta and stuff. Oh yeah, by the way, the Shadow Fiend, Blink Dagger, I wanted to say that. First of all, I'm not an excellent Shadow Fiend player. I do like the hero, I'm a fan of the hero. I don't play it myself much, but I am a fan of the hero. If you ask high skill players, high MMR players, they would say Shadow Blade is better than Blink Dagger. And to be honest, I agree. Shadow Blade makes much more sense than Blink Dagger. Because Blink Dagger doesn't give you any stats, and you don't... I mean, Shadow Blade gives you only attack speed and damage. Shadow Blade doesn't give you any stacks either. But it's much better to have the invisible initiation. Oh, whoa, Blink in and ultimate. That's the old school, basically. The old school Shadow Fiend right there with the Blink Dagger. Alright. Double kill. Triple kill for PA. Now Juggernaut. Is he gonna get him? Remember, 50% evasion on PA. Now he blinks back to the creeps. Nice. And that's it. He's not gonna kill him. That's a 4-for-3 trade from this fight. It's a pretty even trade, actually. The experience change is not much. It's a 4-for-4, actually. I didn't notice. I thought it's a 3-for-4. So that was an even fight. The Shadow Blade on Shadow Fiend. You can gank a lot more. Shadow Fiend becomes from a passive farmer to a very good ganker. Shadow Blade, going close to someone that's farming a lane or farming neutrals, ultimate into his face. You know Shadow Fiend Requiem of Souls, right? The closer you are to the enemy, the more damage you deal. Shadow Fiend allows you to get extremely close. Shadow Fiend allows you to get right next to the enemy. Unless they have a sentry and they see you. But, you know, if the people in 6k games do Shadow Blade, then in the 3k games it's going to be even better. Because no matter how many sentries the enemy has, you should always be able to find some ganks somewhere on somebody with your Shadow Blade and Requiem of Souls. Also, the damage from Shadow Blade and the attack speed is very useful for Shadow Fiend, because that's what Shadow Fiend is about. The raises are used early game for farming, right, and pushing lanes just like that. You cast two raises and then the creep wave is gone, and what you do is right click mostly in the fights and also the ultimate. So this build is not bad, but an even better build for Shadow Fiend would be to have Shadow Blade Manta style BKB. I think that's the perfect build for Shadow Fiend. Just trust me and try the Shadow Blade. Remember to initiate with it, with your ultimate. And remember to gank with it. That's what it's for, to gank people. You don't really need the 150 bonus damage right click from Shadow Blade. What you need is to get in front, get next to the enemy, ultimate in their face, and basically one shot them. Shadow Fiend's ultimate can one shot people. I have seen it happening a lot. Now let's take a look at the Juggernaut. Face Boots, Battle Fury, Yasha, Satanic. This is a very early Satanic. It's a not bad build, not at all. But the Satanic, I think, should be bought later. MKB before Satanic, definitely. Because Phantom Assassin has 50% evasion already from the spell, and Shadow Fiend has possible evasion too. He might buy a butterfly. A lot of people buy butterfly. It's good in almost every game on Shadow Fiend. So MKB, but you cannot Dire's really go MKB after the Shadow Blade, after the Battle Fury. Excuse me. Oh, there is going to be a big team fight. Okay. I am definitely not missing. This is a big team fight. 31 minutes into the game, a team fight in the middle of the map. This can lead to barracks. Easily. The team that loses the team fight might lose Rux at this point of the game. So, real quick about the Juggernaut. Battle Fury, right after the Battle Fury, you cannot really get Monkey King Bar because it doesn't give you any HP. You need survivability first. In my opinion, the best build is Battle Fury, Sanjin Yasha, or Manta is okay too. Battle Fury, Manta, and then Monkey King Bar, and then go for the Satanic. Okay? Definitely need some stats, because Battle Fury is only a farming build, a farming item. Damage and splash damage, so you can farm. Farming item. MKB is DPS item, so you don't miss your auto attacks. And where is the HP at? You are extremely squishy, and you should not be. So, Battle Fury, Manta Style, MKB, and then the Satanic would be a much better build for Juggernaut than going for this. It's way too early Satanic in this game. It's not gonna do huge work.
Dire's bottom tower is under
but it's still
attack.
Good though. Dire's so let's see what's going on in here. Fallen. Viper running into the enemy. He's gonna die really fast. Echo Slam. Ice Bath.
Radiant's middle tower is under attack.
Okay. I need to go back into it again.
Radiant's middle tower is under attack.
Okay. First thing is first. Viper jumps in. Into five people. Didn't wait for his team. Look at where the Jakiro is. Look at where the Vengeful Spirit is. If you wanna initiate a team fight, look at the teammates, look at the minimap. So first of all, Viper runs into five people and dies really fast. Alone. Nobody can help him, nobody can do anything. Alright, so this is another big thing. Check this out. Shadow Fiend BKB, Phantom Assassin BKB, Axis repelled by Omni Knight. All three carry heroes from the Radiant team are immune to magic. So automatically means Earthshaker doesn't do anything with his spells, Jakiro doesn't do anything with his spells, and then there is Guardian Angel to stop Juggernaut's ultimate from, I mean, damage from the ultimate, because it's physical, and Guardian Angel gives you armor. It doesn't give you armor, it gives you immunity to physical damage. Alright, there we go, and this fight is basically over.
Radiant's middle tower is under attack.
Alright, so Omni Knight died, he couldn't use the Guardian Angel, but it's still perfectly fine for him, because it's a 1-for-4 trade. I wouldn't care if I died like that as an Omni Knight. Because my team killed 4 heroes, 1-for-4 trade, perfect. Definitely what Dire team should have done is to be more patient. Now when we are watching, it's very easy to say, of course, when the fight is over and all that stuff, we can say, it's so easy to say that they should have waited on the high ground. But they are in a situation where they have an advantage. The kills are 46 for the Dire and 29 for the Radiant. So Dire is like, oh, we are winning really hard, let's fight. And they could fight, but it just should have been a different kind of fight. Viper should have waited for teammates first, before jumping into 5 people. Earthshaker, the poor guy didn't even get to use his own BKB, he died before that. And his ultimate didn't deal any damage. Now they are chasing people. After losing the racks, they are trying to get some trade. But I don't think there will be any trades. Nope, Rubick didn't die. Rubick just tipped it out.
Top tower is under attack.
So yeah, just a bad fight. Do you see what I mean? Remember that I said earlier? You lose the game as a team. You win the game as a team. You do everything as a team. Like, Dire team was winning and they are still... No, they are not winning anymore. Now Radiant has advantage. So, they were winning really hard. And they take one bad team fight. And then they just... suddenly lose the barracks. It's really big for the Radiant to be able to get that one Rax advantage, considering they were losing the game. I wanna talk about the Shadow Feet, the Earthshaker, and then the Vengeful Spirit as offlane hero. And played Vengeful Spirit played as a carry or core in general. So Earthshaker, BKB after the Blink Dagger. Phantom Assassin can right-click you, even if you have BKB. She has a Basher. Basher goes through magic immunity as well. This is going to be Roche for Dire, by the way. I don't think Radiant can contest in time. They are too late for it. So, Earthshaker... PA can right-click you through the BKB. Rubick can steal your Echo Slam through the magic immunity because pierces spell immunity? Yes. Axe can call you through the magic immunity and make you hit him. And then Shadow Fiend can just right click you. It's very simple. In general, BKB on Earthshaker is not a bad item, but in this game, it would have been better if he got a 4 staff instead. Because if something happens and you don't get a good enough blink in, you can force yourself out and then blink in for a second time and Echo Slam when the enemy's BKBs have expired already. Something like that. The more mobility you have on heroes like... Whoa, that's a big Echo Slam. Alright, let me see. Let's see this team fight. I wanna finish first. The more mobility you have on heroes like... Axe, Earthshaker, Magnus, Sand King, the better. Those heroes are all about getting their ultimates off and good disables slash initiation slash, like, it's basically for the utility. So the more mobility you have on those kind of heroes, the better. Both Blink and Force Staff are good on heroes like Shaker, Sand King, Axe, Magnus, blah 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 blah. Let's go. This is a perfect Echo Slam. We saw it already. Completely unexpected, to be honest. Right after the repel expired, it's a perfectly timed Echo. Oh, definitely should have BKB'd. He did a BKB in time. Alright, there is an MKB on the Juggernaut now, double kill, 4 for 3 trade so far, PA is alone. So they still won the fight. Now they can get Radiant's the tier 2 tower. It was a good fight for the Dire. Nice. And he didn't even lose the Aegis. What Earthshaker should have done is actually use the BKB after the Echo Slam. But something even better, to be honest, is to use the BKB before the Echo Slam if you wanna BKB jump in. Because what happened is he took way too much damage from the Shadow Fiend ult. And don't get me wrong, I mean, he's alive right now, right? He's not dead. He survived the team fight. And Juggernaut should not be here anymore. He is alone. He's dead. And now he's gonna get lifted because the Omni Slash is on cooldown. Yeah. Now at this point of the game, he's dead for 80 seconds, which is a lot. He does have buyback. Good thing he has buyback. And he has to use the buyback. Otherwise, he loses mid lane Rux. He definitely shouldn't have stayed there. When everyone is respawning from the Radiant, he should have just run because they have all the disables and stuff. Earthshaker backed to defend the bottom lane. Basically, he was alone. Another nice Echo Slam. And then BKB. Omni Slash is up. PA. PA is gonna die here to right clicks. Axe dies on the tier 4 tower. Actually, PA is not dead yet. He gets healed by the mechanism and the purification. Very nice 3-man fissure by the Earthshaker. There goes the Guardian Angel. But PA still died. Shadow Fiend died as well. Omni Knight gets swapped back. And talking about the swap, I remember that I wanted to talk about the Vengeful Spirit. And basically Vengeful Spirit offlane. Or Vengeful Spirit carry, my thoughts on that. I haven't tried it yet. I never played Vengeful Spirit as a carry or a core position, mid lane or off lane farming. But I don't think it's good because it offers you only right click. And right click is not something really needed. By the way, Dire team should run right now. They bought back on the Juggernaut. They shouldn't fight. Jakiro gets caught because he turned for some reason. Now Vengeful Spirit turned so he can stun, but then he died. And this is so not good. They were really out of position. Jakiro has buyback, Vengeful Spirit does not. They might lose Rux here. This is very risky for the Juggernaut. He has to play the next fight perfectly. Because if he dies, he doesn't have buyback. He just used it a minute ago. So if he dies again, they lose the game for sure. I can't believe. 36 to 54? Dire's middle tower is under attack. And they could possibly lose the game right now. Okay, Viper doing a lot of work with right clicks. No sorceries avail. I'm losing my voice already. Help. Too much talking. What was I saying? The Vengeful Spirit core carry. It only offers you right click. If you think about it, the stun, the wave, the aura, the swaps, you can do them as a support as well. It's not something that you get as an extra, as a carry. The only thing you get is right click, and that's not really needed. Earthshaker immediately buys back. That's the great decision there. Nice, Echo Slam. Guardian Angel is up. Phantom Assassin. Triple kill for him. Somebody killed the healing ward. Rubik stole the healing ward. place their own healing ward, it really means a lot because it's level 4. And Juggernaut is dead. Everyone is dead. Game is over. Game is over. I'm telling you. They don't have any buybacks on the Dire team. Game is over. So, Vengeful Spirit carry. The only thing is the right click. It could be good. In this game it's not bad, to be honest. They just lost it because of bad fights and getting picked off, like Juggernaut dying twice with the Aegis in the enemy's base here, and then using the buyback when the buyback could be saved instead. And then after that, Vengeful Spirit and Jakiro dying close to the Radiant base again, leading to another push by the Radiant. It's just Dire team made some really poor decisions individually and also as a team. Like the Juggernaut alone dying there and then spending the buyback. And then that fight next to the Roche Pit that they took, that they lost. I gotta say, well played by the Radiant. Even now, 42 minutes in, the kills are still in advantage for Dire. But as you can see, kills are not always very important. Vengeful Spirit carry. Yeah, the pro players might be doing it and all that stuff. It might be popular at the moment in the tournament games. But you don't really have to copy the pro players and what they do, because they are pros for a reason. They know much more than us about this game, right? So what they are doing good, we might not do so good. So they understand the Vengeful Spirit as a core, but I don't really know if it's good or not. I can't say if it's good or not. I prefer playing Vengeful Spirit as a support, that's all, not as a carry. Maybe the Aura could be used in a certain draft. The captain of the team has an idea and game plan in his mind and they pick the Vengeful Spirit for that. But I would recommend you guys just go for normal carry picks or offlane picks. For example, Magnus would have been really good in this game as an offlane. Magnus with Juggernaut, you have the empower to buff him and give him even more splash damage and increase his damage, because empower increases the damage. The RP is super good spell to disable one or five even enemy heroes. If you get a good RP off, that can mean you the team fight. And the RP goes through magic immunity, so no matter how many BKBs the Radiant had, they had two and one repel by Omni Knight. RP would stun them anyway because it goes through magic immunity. So definitely Magnus would have been a much better choice than Vengeful Spirit, and other offlaners would be better choices as well, to be honest. Just play your Vengeful Spirit as a support, that's all. One thing that could be cool for the Dire team and in general against Omni Knight is a Diffusal Blade. Maybe Venge could have gone for a Diffusal instead of Desolator, or Juggernaut could have bought a Diffusal Blade. I don't think the Viper should buy one, definitely not. Earthshaker or Jakiro, no, because they are supports. I mean, even if they are supports, they can still buy the item, but they have other items more important to buy. So Vengeful Spirit or Juggernaut would have been useful if they picked up a Diffusal Blade, because it removes the Omni Knight repel and the Guardian Angel. If you're focusing somebody and he has he's affected by the Guardian Angel, the Omni Knight's ultimate, you can just purge him with the Diffusal Blade and remove that. And then you just kill him. Diffusal Blade is generally good against Omni Knight. It's decent counter. So that's it for this video, guys. Thank you for watching. If you enjoyed the video, please leave a like, it helps out a lot. If you are new to my channel, feel free to subscribe. Thank you for watching, and I will see you in the next one. Good luck, and have fun playing Dota.